tragic fire. A deadly blaze strikes a Coptic Christian church in Egypt. We have details. Ratcheting tensions. China issues new military threats after another visit by U.S. lawmakers to Taiwan. Distorting a saint. How a premiering play takes artistic license with a patron of France. And Mother Angelica's mission, celebrating how a nun's faith launched a platform to proclaim the gospel. On EWTN News Nightly for Monday, August 15th, 2022. Thank you so much for being with us tonight on this Solemnity of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. I'm Tracy Sable. Coptic Orthodox Christians in Egypt are mourning the loss of at least 40 people who died in a church fire. A procession of coffins enters one of two churches where funerals were held today. The fire killed the parish priest and many children. At least 14 others were injured. An electrical failure is suspected to be the cause of the fire. China announces that it will continue military drills around Taiwan. The latest word follows a new visit by U.S. lawmakers to the South Rhode Island, led by Senator Ed Markey. Beijing calls American talks with Taipei's leaders a violation of its national sovereignty. China began war games earlier this month after House Speaker Nancy Pelosi visited Taiwan. And joining us now to discuss is Gordon Chang, author of The Coming Collapse of China and the Great U.S.-China Tech War. Gordon, great to be with you. As mentioned, more U.S. lawmakers visited Taiwan over the weekend. Your thoughts on the visit, what it symbolizes and what it signals to China?
The signal from this visit is that the United States will not be intimidated. You know, Beijing can huff and puff, it can scream, it can yell, it can try to intimidate, but Congress clearly is not. Speaker Pelosi was not, and Senator Ed Markey was not. But who was intimidated was President Biden, who has tried to prevent Speaker Pelosi's trip. These delegations are important because they say to Beijing, look, we are not going to give in to threats, which means we are not going to legitimize and we are not going to embolden the worst elements in the Chinese political system by showing everybody else that intimidation works.
Yeah, and in response to the visit, China carried out some military drills, calling them, quote, stern deterrent to the United States and Taiwan continuing to play political tricks and undermine peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait. Your reaction, Gordon?
Well, these Chinese drills, especially the ones that followed Speaker Pelosi's visit, were especially provocative because China declared 6 and then 7 live fire exclusion zones. One of those zones to the southwest of the main island of Taiwan was so close that it actually infringed on sovereign Taiwan airspace and water. And, you know, what clearly Beijing is trying to practice an embargo. So the United States needs to preposition supplies and munitions on the island because we may not be able to get to it right away because of these Chinese exclusion zones.
Yeah, and Gordon, another thing I want to touch on is this trade ban that China has placed on a number of products from Taiwan, including seafood, citing COVID as the reason. However, the timing is pretty curious as it seemed to line up with Speaker Pelosi's visit to the island nation. What more do you know about this and also the impact that it could have on Taiwan's economy?
Yeah, these bans on Taiwan products really affect very, very few of them. What would be important is, and this would be significant, but China didn't do it, would be a ban on semiconductors that Taiwan makes, which China absolutely needs. So Beijing was signaling here that it was upset, but it wasn't really going to impose a ban that would hurt either Taiwan or China.
Yeah, and switching gears just a bit here, Henry Kissinger, former Secretary of State, recently wrote a book where he expressed concern over America inching closer to war with both Russia and China. What do you think? I mean, do you think that we're headed in that direction?
We're certainly headed in that direction, Tracy. You know, Kissinger, in that July interview he gave the Wall Street Journal, which was published on Friday, actually said we are on the edge of war with Russia and China. And I actually think that he is right. The Chinese are actually been preparing for war for 2 years. They're trying to mobilize all of society. And that means that Xi Jinping is serious. You know, I think the Chinese understand that war would not be in China's best interest. But emotionally, Xi Jinping and the flag officers, the generals and admirals, they really want to kill somebody. And so, therefore, when you have a state that does that, feels that way, they usually succeed in starting a conflict of some sort because they really are just itching to kill Americans right now.
Something else to touch on, too. The New York Times reporting that members of Congress are growing frustrated with the Biden administration's lack of movement on ensuring Americans' data is protected while using apps like TikTok. Can we talk more about this and how much China is gaining from having access to this data?
China is gaining all sorts of access, and a lot of it will be used for blackmail purposes, for intimidation purposes, but also just in general, the data that China is collecting feeds into their artificial intelligence systems. And the more data you put into AI, the better it is. And the thing here that's ominous is that China is prohibiting the transfer of Chinese data out of China, including DNA profiles. So while they're hoovering up our DNA, they're preventing us from looking at Chinese DNA. That certainly indicates that they've got a biological weapons program.
Gordon, we have probably about a minute left or so, but before I let you go, any final thoughts?
Well, right now, you know, the Biden administration should be banning TikTok. President Trump banned it. President Biden lifted that ban. But we know that in 2020, according to reporting from a federal government unit, that TikTok was fomenting violence on American streets. That's not just a federal crime. That is an act of war. And yet the Biden administration's not doing anything about this. This is a dereliction of President Biden's highest constitutional obligation, which is to defend the American people from foreign attack. I think the American people should start asking their president, what is he doing? Because this just makes no sense whatsoever.
Yeah, and Gordon, we're going to leave it right there. Thank you so much, as always, for your time and your analysis. Always appreciate it.
Thank you, Tracy.
Our court records show the FBI took 11 boxes of documents from former President Donald Trump's Mar-a-Lago estate. There is no specific detail about the contents other than reports that some of the recovered papers had varying degrees of special classification. Meanwhile, GOP lawmakers want additional transparency from the Justice Department after last week's search. Idaho's highest court will allow enforcement of the state's pro-life laws while legal challenges proceed. A ruling late Friday holds that bans on abortion may take effect on August 25th. The decision went against lawsuits filed by abortion advocates. Arkansas voters may have recently defeated a pro-life amendment to the state's constitution, but a pro-life supporter in the state has offered to pay for a hand recount. The referendum was the first popular vote on abortion after the overturning of Roe versus Wade. The author Salman Rushdie is on the road to recovery after suffering serious injuries on Friday before delivering a lecture in upstate New York. The 75-year-old was rushed to the hospital after being stabbed around a dozen times. A 24-year-old man has been arrested and pleaded not guilty. Rushdie's 1988 book, The Satanic Verses, included scenes that some Muslims considered blasphemy. The then Supreme Leader of Iran called for Rushdie's killing. Over the weekend, an Iranian government spokesman said Tehran was not involved in the attack. President Joe Biden has condemned the attack on Rushdie, calling him courageous and resilient. Meantime, the president is also speaking out about the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act. He says the American people won and special interests lost.
The American people are going to see lower prescription drug prices, lower health care costs, and lower energy costs.
President Joe Biden plans to sign the Inflation Reduction Act this week. It will come in the midst of his vacation, where his public appearances have been limited to a bike ride and a trip to Mass. Also on vacation, Vice President Kamala Harris. She, too, praised the Democrats' big spending bill during a stop in California on her way to Hawaii.
It's also going to be an investment in infrastructure. It's going to be an investment in jobs, all of the work that needs to happen to allow us to be resilient.
The White House says it's making plans to promote the climate, tax, and health bill by sending cabinet secretaries to nearly two dozen states over the next 2 weeks. The president also plans to hold a big event after Labor Day, touting the bill that Republicans rejected as a, quote, disastrous big government socialism bill that will exacerbate the recession and increase inflation. Well, today marks 1 year since the Taliban seized the capital of Afghanistan. Taliban fighters celebrated in Kabul as part of a national holiday. But Afghanistan's economy is in a downturn and the government remains internationally isolated after a year in control. It has also struggled to control militants who have kept up attacks against unprotected targets across the country. Coming up, a Central American government takes new action against worshiping Catholics. Plus, a new play about a beloved saint takes liberties with her identity. The procession to Our Lady of Fatima planned in Nicaragua over the weekend was canceled by the government. Instead, the faithful gathered for Mass. The cancellation was the latest incident between the government and church leaders. Earlier this month, President Daniel Ortega closed seven radio stations owned by the church. At a Mass on Sunday, Cardinal Leopoldo Bresnes addressed the tensions, saying, "Forgive them, Lord. They know not what they do." On Friday, the Vatican also expressed concern over the situation in Nicaragua. A court in Myanmar has convicted the country's ousted elected leader on more corruption charges. Aung San Suu Kyi was sentenced to 6 years in prison, adding to the 11 years she is already serving. The former Nobel Peace Prize winner denied all charges during the closed-door trial. Her lawyers plan to appeal. The military now controls the country, also known as Burma. A new article published by The Atlantic magazine online says the rosary has become an extremist symbol. The online headline said, quote, "How the rosary became an extremist symbol," and it featured bullet holes in place of rosary beads. The headline was later changed to "How extremist gun culture is trying to co-opt the rosary." The article accuses Catholics of demonizing their opposition, adding that in some cases, quote, "The sacramental rosary isn't just a spiritual weapon, but one that comes with physical ammunition." Meantime, the Globe Theater in London is calling a show called I, Joan, a rendition of the story of Joan of Arc, with the title character using the pronouns they, them. The theater explained the choice to use those pronouns, saying, quote, "Shakespeare was not afraid of discomfort, and neither is the Globe. History has provided countless and wonderful examples of Joan portrayed as a woman. This production is simply offering the possibility of another point of view." That is the role of theater, to simply ask the question, imagine if. And joining us now to discuss is Mary Margaret Olohan, D.C. correspondent at The Daily Wire. Mary Margaret, great to be with you as always. I want to talk about Joan of Arc, but first, I'd like to get your thoughts on that Atlantic article linking the rosary to violence and extremism.
Well, it's insane. You know, in the span of a week, we've seen two different pieces from The Atlantic trying to paint pro-lifers and Christians as these radicals, pro-lifers, Catholics, and Christians as these radicals who want these radical things. When at the end of the day, the things that The Atlantic appears to be upset about is that these pro-lifers and Catholics want to save babies. So last week, we saw a piece from The Atlantic talking about how pro-lifers are latching on to Jane's Revenge, this group that has been attacking pro-life centers and organizations all over the country. This week, we saw a piece from The Atlantic saying that the rosary is an extremist symbol. Now, Catholics know that the rosary is not an extremist symbol. It is, however, a very powerful spiritual weapon that Catholics use to ask God for what they need, to ask Mary what they need, and it is an extremely powerful spiritual weapon. But there is no whatsoever, no far-right, radical, white supremacist connotations to this whatsoever. And to suggest that it is frankly anti-Catholic bigotry. And we've been hearing a lot of this type of thing. You know, we've seen Amy Coney Barrett attacked for her Catholic faith. We've seen a lot of different traditional Catholics being attacked for their faith because they stand for traditional Catholicism. And traditional Catholicism completely contradicts many of these leftist principles, such as same-sex marriage, abortion, a lot of different things, euthanasia. Traditional Catholicism stands for the truth. And so at the end of the day, leftists and The Atlantic apparently can't handle that.
Yeah, and as we mentioned, you know, the original headline of the article was changed. What do you think was behind that change? And also, you mentioned this traditional Catholic. He mentions this phrase a lot, radical traditional Catholic, throughout the article. What do you think he is possibly implying by that? He meaning the writer.
Well, he's implying that traditional Catholics aren't actually real Catholics, and that perhaps these real Catholics are kind of a new wave of Catholics that believe new things. And I wouldn't be surprised at all if this progressive Catholics for Choice group had something to do with these types of pieces, because this is part of a very, very purposeful campaign to change Catholicism and to help American Catholics think that Catholicism changes. But we know for a fact that Catholicism does not change. The truth doesn't change. Since the beginning of the Catholic Church, the same precepts have been there. Catholicism and truth does not change, however much an insignificant Atlantic writer might want it to.
Okay, now I want to move on to this Joan of Arc being portrayed as a character that doesn't identify as a woman. Mary Margaret, your reaction to that, and how does that impact the story being told?
Well, it's outrageous. I mean, Joan of Arc is my favorite saint. I wear her medal every single day. She's my confirmation saint. I love her because she really embodies true womanhood. She channeled her femininity to use for heroism. And she led the French army against the English as a woman in a time when women didn't even wear pants, much less ride horses into battle and lead an army against the English. And her story is true. It's not some fictional tale of heroism. And it's one of the earliest stories of female courage and victory that we have. And yet this theater group seems to think that they can take this amazing, powerful story of Catholic femininity and courage and turn it to fit their ideological purposes. Well, I mean, there's been a lot of backlash to that because a lot of people love St. Joan. A lot of people admire her bravery and her femininity and her courage. And this weaponizing of her story for ideological purposes, frankly, it reeks of the same anti-Catholic sentiment that we were just talking about before. Why are all these really beautiful things like the Rosary and St. Joan of Arc being weaponized in this way? It begs the question of who wants to be kind of corrupting these things and changing them to fit their ideological purposes.
Yeah, disturbing and great question right there, Mary Margaret. Before I let you go, we have a little less than a minute left. Any final thoughts?
Well, I think that this is a really good opportunity to share St. Joan of Arc's story with a lot of other people. My favorite book that is written about St. Joan of Arc and what inspired me to choose her as my confirmation saint was actually written by Mark Twain, who wrote Tom Sawyer. So you would never think that he would have written a great book about St. Joan of Arc. But he did, in fact, and it's an amazing story that kind of travels along with her and tells her story of how she was called by God to lead the French and how she went. And she was ultimately burned at the stake under false heresy charges for doing what God told her to do. And so she's not only a hero, she's a martyr of the Catholic Church. It's an incredibly inspiring story, and I think it's so great for women to hear about this day and age, but also men too.
Absolutely. And Mary Margaret, thank you so much for coming on and weighing in. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Up next, how the Blessed Mother's Assumption is honored at the Vatican and around the world. Plus, celebrating the day when Mother Angelica's vision went on the air. Pope Francis challenges the faithful to rekindle the flame of faith.
Il Vangelo della liturgia odierna c'è un'espressione di Gesù.
During his remarks about yesterday's gospel at the Vatican, the Holy Father says Jesus' reference to the fire of faith should inspire us to conversion, not complacency. Pope Francis says faith is not a lullaby, but a living flame to keep us wakeful and active. The Holy Father also spoke today in celebration of the Feast of the Assumption, saying the Blessed Mother takes us by the hand, inviting us to rejoice.
Il Vangelo ci propone il dialogo tra lei e la cugina Elisabetta.
In his remarks at the Vatican, Pope Francis says Mary's Assumption shows us that heaven is within our reach. The Holy Father says that we should feel the joy and wonder expressed by Mary in her Magnificat when she visited her cousin Elizabeth. Well, the Solemnity of the Blessed Virgin Mary is celebrated around the world, but it means slightly different things to different faith traditions. EWTN Vatican producer Benjamin Crockett has more.
Today in Italy, we celebrate Ferragosto, a day that commemorates the Assumption of the Virgin Mary into heaven. Being the mother of Jesus and being preserved from the stain of sin, Mary, like Jesus, was raised by God to eternal life. The Assumption does not necessarily imply Mary's death, but neither does it exclude it. The various Christian denominations diverge on this point. Orthodox and Armenians celebrate only the Dormition of Mary on August 15th. It is called the Dormition because Mary would not really have died, but only fallen into a deep sleep. Protestants, on the other hand, do not believe in Mary's Assumption and do not celebrate because it is not narrated in the Gospel. It was Pope Pius XII on November 1st, 1950, a holy year, who solemnly proclaimed for the Catholic Church as a dogma of faith the Assumption of the Virgin Mary into heaven. The term Ferragosto derives from the Latin expression fare Augusti, or Augustan rest, which indicated a holiday established by Emperor Augustus in 18 BC. The ancient Ferragosto, in addition to its obvious purposes of political self-promotion, was intended to link the major Augustan holidays to provide an adequate period of rest, also known as Augustali, that was needed after the great exertions expended during the preceding weeks. The holiday originally fell on August 1st. The shift to the 15th of the month was due to the Catholic Church, which decided to make the secular holiday coincide with the religious feast of the Assumption of Mary. In the popular Italian tradition, Ferragosto is a vacation that usually coincides with the vacation season. As with other holidays, it is usually celebrated outside the city, especially at the seaside. Ferragosto in the Vatican has always been a special day. For about 60 years, the various popes used to travel during the warmer months to Castel Gandolfo, a small village outside of Rome in front of Lake Albano, and the summer residence for the popes. In fact, the day of Ferragosto included the recitation of the Angelus from the window of the Apostolic Palace in Castel Gandolfo, where the pope was staying, and not from St. Peter's Square. Pope Francis ended this long and historic tradition in 2014 on that occasion. In fact, the Holy Father was in South Korea for an apostolic trip, and in the following years, having never gone to the summer residence of Castel Gandolfo, the traditional recitation of the Angelus away from the Vatican was consequently skipped.
Festeggiamola gioiosi ma umili.
Just last year, addressing the faithful gathered in St. Peter's Square, Pope Francis recalled that Mary, in her littleness, conquers the heavens first. The secret of her success lies precisely in recognizing herself as small, in recognizing herself as needy. As on December 8th, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, Catholics in Italy today pause to celebrate Mary, who holds together the three most important truths of the Catholic Church: immaculate from her conception, Mother of God in her saving mission, and finally, assumed into heaven in her final predestination alongside Christ. In Rome, Benjamin Crockett, EWTN News Nightly.
And finally tonight for EWTN, today is more than the Solemnity of the Assumption. It is also the 41st anniversary of the network's on-air launch.
May his eternal word be proclaimed.
EWTN foundress Mother Angelica flipped the switch on this day back in 1981, surrounded by her community of religious sisters from the Poor Clares. EWTN started with just $200 and reached 60,000 viewers for a few hours a day. Now the network reaches 380 million households in more than 150 countries via television, radio, and the internet. It is all part of Mother Angelica's mission to spread the splendor of Christ's church to the entire world. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.